welcome to everyone on the eve of St. Patrick's Day to this penultimate event in the Trinity Business Ethics Speaker Series for 2022-23. My name is Daniel Milan. I am the director of the newly established Trinity Corporate Governance Lab, which will be the new host for the series moving forward. We'll continue to work very closely with the Trinity Center for Social Innovation, which has supported and hosted us since the inception event way back in 2020. And I'd like to thank the Trinity Center for being the host. And as I said, we will work closely with them moving forward. More than 3,000 people have either attended live events or watched our recordings on the website. And we have great plans to expand the series for the 2023-24 season. Today, I'm delighted to welcome former colleague and friend Miel Kaptein as our guest speaker. Miel is a professor of business ethics and integrity management at the Department of Business and Society Management at the Rotterdam School of Management at the Erasmus University. His research interests lie in the area of defining, measuring, and managing the ethics of organizations. Miel is the author of 8 books and has published 50 articles in peer-reviewed journals like Journal of Management Studies, Journal of Organizational Behavior, Organization Studies, Journal of Management, and the Academy of Management Review. He was section editor of the Journal of Business Ethics between 2002 and 2019, and teaches courses in corporate social responsibility, leadership, business ethics, and consultancy. Miel is also an equity partner at KPMG, where he helps organizations in developing, protecting, and assessing their ethics, integrity, and compliance. I had the pleasure of working with Miel during those days during my time at KPMG, and I was also fortunate to spend a semester at the Rotterdam School of Management during my own MBA studies many years or decades ago. So for me, it's a double pleasure to welcome an old colleague and also somebody from a school where I was able to spend some time. Miel, it's great to have you here. I'm going to hand over to you in a moment. I would like to invite the audience to please post your questions that you have in the Q&A. After the presentation, I will moderate hopefully a lively discussion, and then we will wrap up on the hour as usual. So once again, a warm welcome to Miel, and over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Daniel. Thank you for those very kind words. It's also a pleasure for me to be invited by you to be part of your program. Welcome all of you. Great that you also attend this session. And as introduced by Daniel, I work in the field of business ethics because I really believe for a long time in the value of business ethics. When I was a business student, well, I followed courses in strategic management, financial management, marketing management, and I thought at that moment, well, why do they expect that organizations should grow, should improve their performance, should increase their market share? And that was for me the reason to explore the field of business ethics. So I work in that field for more than 30 years because business ethics is important, business ethics is valuable, and organizations should manage and implement their ethics well. Well, I'm not the only one believing in the value of ethics. It's everywhere, you can say. Everywhere in the sense of nowadays we expect from companies that they have an eye ethics, that they have an ethics program, that they have a code of conduct, that they have ethics officers, that they create an ethical culture, and that they assess their ethics, and especially, well, that they take the responsibility to their stakeholders, in the sense of that they treat their stakeholders well, that they are open to their stakeholders, that they care for the ecological environment, that they create sustainable value, and so forth, and so forth. And for a long time, I was focused on the ethics of business because I really believe in the value of business ethics. And it, well, maybe refers to this picture that nowadays we expect so much ethics from businesses that they deal well with their stakeholders in an ethical way, and that they even improve themselves every time, so that their ethical performance improves, and that they keep to higher and higher standards. And it's not only that we tend to think about that in society, like people on the street, or that they even think that profit is less important than planet, that organizations should care more about the environment than about their financial performance. But it's also my impression of the current literature in business ethics. So the current field in business ethics stresses well it's about the ethical responsibilities of companies toward their stakeholders. It's how they deal or how they should deal with their stakeholders. We have the belief that when we want to improve society, companies are part of the problem or part of the solution. They have to become more ethical. And more than 20 years ago, already it was said in the literature that most discussions of stakeholder theory, one part but one of the most important theories in business administration, typically begin with the responsibilities of the firm towards its stakeholders. So it's the idea, and maybe also that has to do with the statements in the 70s that it is all about serving your shareholders. That's the only ethical responsibility. So since its inception, business ethics has the idea, the ethical responsibilities of companies is towards all the stakeholders. And this was stated in 2002, so more than 20 years ago. But since then, there is hardly more attention paid to, say, the responsibilities of firms, because there is comparatively little attention paid in the literature to the ethical responsibilities of stakeholders towards companies. So having an overview of the literature in management studies, business ethics, business administration, it seems to me at least, and I follow Andrioff and colleagues with their statement 20 years ago, that still today there is a significant large emphasis on the ethical responsibilities of companies and hardly on the ethical responsibilities of stakeholders. What's the problem, or what's the issue of that? In the literature, I had that seems to suggest that companies have responsibilities and companies have obligations and duties, especially then towards their stakeholders, and that stakeholders seems to have marginally or partly or just in a minor way have responsibilities to themselves, and that stakeholders mainly have rights towards the company. So the companies have obligations and stakeholders have rights towards those companies. And that's it, as far as I can have an overview of the literature, what is nowadays the line of thinking. And this may result, what is to some extent also already indicated in the literature 15 years ago, that stakeholders become, say, passive, and passive in the sense of expecting that all ethics comes from companies. And there are good arguments for that. Companies are powerful, companies have more resources, companies have more knowledge. But do we run the risk yet that we wait until companies take the responsibilities, and that we stakeholders, whether we are consumers, suppliers, employees, shareholders, etc., that we wait until companies take their responsibilities. And until then, yeah, it's just waiting. And what are the risks of that? Well, Goodstein and Wicks gave five reasons why they think that it's very important that stakeholders also take their responsibilities. And maybe, well, it's easiest to imagine that imagine that there would be a very ethical company, but all stakeholders would be very unethical. Can such an organization exist? An organization where the business is very ethical and all stakeholders, investors, suppliers, employees, and consumers are very unethical. Well, I think that would hardly be possible or even impossible. But also the reasons they provide is that the cost of irresponsible stakeholders is very high. When stakeholders are very unethical, it leads to very high costs for companies to monitor the lack of ethics, to come up with very detailed contracts, and etc. You can also say, well, when stakeholders are unethical or opportunistic or indifferent regarding ethics of the company, that would mean that stakeholders would not intervene when an business behaves in an unethical way, would even encourage companies to continue in an to do ethics in an ethical way, and so forth and so forth. So they give five reasons that you can read here, and it's further explained in their 2007 publication. That in the end they say, well, when we want to create a society with that is sustainable, that it's ethical, it depends on stakeholders that also take the responsibility, especially because there are so many challenges. And it's the fifth reason that is not just to be on the plate of companies, but that requires also stakeholders together with companies to take their joint responsibilities. So when that's the idea that it's not only about, say, the responsibilities of companies, of businesses, but also about stakeholders. Well, then we can say by Goodstein and Wicks that without stakeholder responsibility, business doesn't work. Or as Fashion a few years later states, corporate responsibility requires stakeholder responsibility. Or you can say, well, business ethics need stakeholder ethics. It needs ethics of stakeholders. In order that businesses can be ethical, and when businesses are ethical and stakeholders are ethical together, they can improve society and all the issues we face. So the importance of stakeholder ethics, and at the same time in the current literature, hardly any publications about stakeholder ethics. There are some exceptions. A few are listed here, or almost all publications I could find. And it is, for example, Mahoney, that's almost 30 years ago, suggesting, well, we should turn the ethical tables. So it's not only that the companies should take the responsibilities, but also stakeholders. Andrioff said, well, we were suggesting greater thinking in the academic community on stakeholder responsibility is needed. It should be a two-way conversation. It should also be about the obligations of stakeholders. And Fessin suggested that stakeholder responsibility is an overlooked domain. So from a few sources, the suggestion to focus also on, say, the ethics of stakeholders, and especially their ethical responsibility. There are some exceptions, but there are not on, say, stakeholders in general, but more on for specific stakeholders. For example, these are publications that deal about, say, the ethical responsibilities of shareholders, or the ethical responsibilities of consumers or suppliers, or NGOs, but that's more just for one single stakeholder. So the question is there also, say, an overarching theory that ground the ethics of stakeholders and their ethical responsibilities? Well, as far as I know, there is not at this moment a real theoretical ground at all, or that is very sound, that is very helpful in defining why should stakeholders be responsible for a company or to a company. So what I would like to do in this presentation is, try to find some ground, or at least explore some ground. And I'm looking forward to the interaction. But in the meantime, when you have questions, please put them in the chat, and then I can address them immediately. So what I would like to do is define what stakeholder ethics is briefly, and then try to find some ground, and then based on that, give some implications for theory and for practice. And afterwards, by the way, when you like it, I can share and distribute the slides. Briefly, then, what is stakeholder ethics? Well, you can say, well, it's the same as business ethics is defined, but then say replacing business by stakeholders. So stakeholder ethics, you could say, is the discipline. So it's the domain, it's the field, it's the theoretical perspective, but also say the practice of in reality how to define and implement. Just it's the same as for business ethics, but then not the rights and responsibilities of companies, but of stakeholders. And then on the one end to a company, so how should stakeholders behave to a company, what is the ethics they should have in their dealings with a company, but it can also be for a company. And when a company behaves in an unethical way, is there also then a responsibility for stakeholders in that respect? You can also say, by the way, is there also a responsibility that by being a stakeholder, you have also a responsibility to other stakeholders. So at least there are three, say, dimensions. And for now, I will address only the first two. So what are the responsibilities of stakeholders to a company, and what are the responsibilities for a company? So starting with the responsibilities to companies from a stakeholder perspective. How could we ground that ethical responsibility of stakeholders? Well, one theory that can be used is contract theory, or social contract theory. Why is that a promising theory? Because it's a theory that already recognizes that there are two parties that come together, the company and shareholders, the company and consumers, the company and suppliers, and so forth, that have a transaction, so to say, but have also mutual expectations. And contract theory is a well-established theory in business ethics that already recognizes that the contract parties have responsibilities. But current contract theory lay down that theory, but when operationalizing the responsibilities of the contract parties, focus on companies. And can we, instead of talking about companies, talking about stakeholders? One theory that has been developed, or one set of principles that has been developed, is by Huygens 20 years ago. And they develop contract theory, and they come up with, say, principles for contracts, or contracting principles based on the internal morality of contracts. So a contract in itself inherently has some principles, and they base their line of thinking about what are the, say, the contractual conditions and what are the contractual goals and the contractual conditions are bounded rationality and opportunism, and what are the impact or the goals is mutual advantage and sustainable mutual advantage, and they then define, say, four contracting barriers, and for each of those contracting barriers, they define and they propose one contracting principle or one behavioral principle. So empathy is an inherent principle to deal with the problem of desolation, and fairness for the problem of deception. So for each contracting barrier, you have one behavioral principle, and they show that those four principles are covered well in the literature, also by other theories, and they have then one additional principle, and that is openness. And openness contains four different dimensions, each of those dimensions addressing one of those contracting barriers. So in the end, they come up with five principles, of which they say, well, those are contracting principles. They are applicable to all contracting parties, but when operationalizing it, they talk about companies. Companies should show empathy. Companies should be reliable. Companies should be open. But we can, following Mahoney's idea, also turn the table, and instead of talking about companies, we can also talk about stakeholders. And I've done that for you. And Huygens et al. Has defined for each principle four sub-principles, or four items, or four operationalizations. For example, for empathy, they say, well, the contracting party shows serious awareness of its potential interest and corresponding expectations towards the other contracting party. So that's empathy point one. But when we replace that by stakeholder, it reads that the stakeholder shows or should show serious awareness of its potential company's interest. So what are the interests of the company and corresponding expectations? So what I try to do is replace contracting party by stakeholder. And what's the result is for those four principles is shown here. And it seems to me, we have now not the time to discuss this in detail, except you would like to do that, is that it, well, it works, at least for me, that I say, well, yeah, indeed, you can replace contracting party by stakeholder. And it shows then that, yeah, as a contracting party and a partner, a stakeholder should also take its fair share. And that also holds for the openness. Here you see those four sub-principles for openness. And yeah, when those principles holds for all contracting parties, it also not just holds for the company, but also for the other side of the table, so the stakeholder. So this could be a ground that you say, well, stakeholders should also be open. Stakeholders should also show empathy. Stakeholders should also be fair, be in solidarity, and be reliable towards the company. So this could be a ground, a theoretical ground, for the ethical responsibilities of stakeholders to a company. So that is one direction, and a promising direction, I believe, to better ground the ethical responsibilities of stakeholders to the company. But there is the other perspective, and that is stakeholders' responsibility for companies or for business. Do they also have a responsibility, especially when a company behaves in an unethical way? Why should stakeholders not accept that or tolerate that or just, do nothing or stay inactive? Why do they also have a responsibility because they are a stakeholder? And so what is the responsibility? Not just because they are citizen, no, because they are a stakeholder, that brings with it some responsibility. Well, in the literature, all kinds of grounds are given for why stakeholders, usually focusing on shareholders, by the way, have a responsibility for, say, the ethics of a company. But it's not from, say, a contractual perspective. So those grounds can also be treated or viewed from, say, a contractual perspective. So the first ground is when you are a stakeholder, when you have a contract with a company as a stakeholder, in that sense, you endorse the company. You support that company by a contract. You vote for the company. You endorse that. So closing a contract, hypothetical, or it's not about real contracts, but hypothetical contracts or implicit or informal contracts. That's social contract theory. You endorse by that the company. There's also the idea, I think, that by viewing relationship between stakeholders and the company as contracts, that's also that you enable as a stakeholder the company. You provide resources. The contract is an exchange of resources. So by providing resources, you become also responsible for how those resources are used by a company. So that could be a second ground for also holding a stakeholder responsible for what an organization, a company, is doing. You can also say, well, there is also, say, the influence ground, the influence factor. The fact that contracts are negotiated means, well, that you have room to influence the behavior and the practices of a company. So that could also be a ground. Did you use your influence as a stakeholder to encourage the company in an ethical direction? Fourth, you can also say, well, when there is a contract, well, the idea is, well, that there is mutual advantage and that there is sustainable mutual advantage, so that you profit as a stakeholder from the relationship, but not just from the relationship, also from the operations of the company. So when an organization behaves in an unethical way, you can also say, well, that makes you also responsible when you profit from the benefits of that unethical practice. That could also imply your responsibility. And fifth, you can also say, well, and that's also the idea of contract theory, that what is a company? A company is the result of different contracts. All the stakeholders that have all kinds of contracts with the company, that creates a company, that makes the company. So a stakeholder in that respect also owns the company. So the company is not the company as such, but the company is the result of all the stakeholders interacting with each other and delivering resources and benefiting from that. So there are five grounds that can be brought in also when speaking about, say, from a contract perspective, why should stakeholders be responsible for the ethics of a company? Well, what's the advantages of this approach is that not every person in the world has a responsibility for every organization. That would be unrealistic. But it would only imply, or it implies, that only stakeholders who have a contractual relationship. So when you are a citizen living nearby a company, that doesn't make you responsible for the behavior of that company, because you don't have, just as a neighbor, have a contractual relationship. But when you have a transaction with a company, when you interact with a company, when there is an exchange of things, then that creates a responsibility. So it's limited in the sense of who's responsible for the ethics of a company. It also implies that it doesn't remove the responsibility or reduce the responsibility of a company when stakeholders have also a responsibility for the ethics of the company, but it adds to that, so it complements that. And what I think is especially important is, so there are some studies also trying to come up with a ground or the ground why, in this case, Irvine and Sandberg, shareholders have an ethical responsibility for the ethics of a company. But you can also say, why should we have just one ground? Why is it not possible that those different grounds are different arguments that together make a strong case for the ethical responsibilities of stakeholders So it's not the one or the other, but it's both. And that complementary grounds is also, by the way, but it's not a sound argument consistent with empirical findings that stakeholders in reality have mixed motives why they respond to unethical behavior of a company. And that they also do that because, well, they endorse it, they influence it, etc. And my idea would be that the more these grounding factors or these grounds separately and jointly are present in a contractual relationship, these factors are present, for example, when I'm a supplier in relation to a company, the more in that respect, the supplier or in more general, the stakeholder is responsible for the ethics of a company. Those five factors sum up and determine the level of your responsibility as a stakeholder for the ethics of a company. So what does that mean? Well, and this is just in 1 minute, what I think, and then I come with a conclusion and one slide with the implications. But this is, well, what I'm now thinking too is why should stakeholders respond as they should respond? I thought, well, you have those five factors, and those five factors mean stakeholders bear the responsibility because they endorse, enable, influence, profit, and own. So a stakeholder shows a positive response, meaning when a company behave in an ethical way by endorsing it more. That as a stakeholder, you say, well, that's great that the organization has done this or that, or that you say, well, I'm going to provide more resources, or that I become closer to the organization, or that it's become more profitable, or that I, for example, say, well, I'm going to work harder or longer or invest more, or buy more shares. So that's a positive response. And what could be then, say, a negative response when you try to reduce the factor? By disapproving when the organization acts in an unethical way, or that you disable providing less resources, or that you say, well, I step down from that committee, drawing back, or that you say, well, part of the profits I received based on the unethical performance of the organization, I give it back to the company, or I give it to another goal, or I, in the end, divest by, for example, selling my shares. So this could be a way to also suggest stakeholders how they should deal when an organization or a company acts in an ethical way or in an unethical way. Well, this brings us to a few conclusions. But I think it's well, I'm not sure that it's realistic, but at least for now, I would say that contracting theory, contract theory, helps us to say, well, stakeholders have a responsibility to companies, the responsibility to implement those five principles in their dealings with the company of which they are a stakeholder. A contract, as a second bullet, helps also, contract theory also helps to ground why stakeholders have a responsibility for the ethics of a company. And those factors also help to find what stakeholders should do, the final table. But of course, more research should be done in stakeholder ethics because it's quite new still. Stakeholder ethics as such is not a term, by the way, that is used in the literature in order, in the end, to make society more ethical. And finally, what are some implications? For this moment, the implication would be from a societal point of view, but also from a company point of view, and also from a stakeholder point of view, that stakeholders have a responsibility, an ethical responsibility, and I think even a huge responsibility because of the stake they have or the stake they hold in an organization, in a company, and that to make that clearer means that using those five contracting principles, that stakeholders should be empathetic, fair, in solidarity, reliable, and open towards the companies of which they are stakeholders. So not to every company, but of those companies of which they are a stakeholder. And at the same time, stakeholders should take action when the company of which they are stakeholder behaves unethically, because those five grounds makes you also responsible for unethical behavior. But the question, of course, is that in all circumstances, is that depending on the level of unethical practices, etc. But that's for later on. And I think also a practical implication. I know some codes of companies, and they usually define their own responsibilities. But I think also that companies have good ground to also point out to stakeholders what their responsibilities are. And when each of the both sides of the table take the responsibility, we will live in the future in a better world. So that's for now. Closing this part of the presentation and going back to you, Daniel.
Well, thank you so much. Really interesting and thought-provoking, this way of expanding the scope of ethical responsibility, if you like. So thank you so much for that. We have about 20 minutes for discussion. And as I indicated in the chat, because we are sort of a relatively small and more intimate group, what I'm going to do is to promote everybody to panelists. And I think I'm going to start with Ryan, because Ryan has been quite active in the Q&A. And Ryan, perhaps you can then pick one or two of those questions, first of all, to get the discussion going, and ask it directly to Mial, so that we can have more of an interactive discussion. So it's going to take me probably about a minute just to go through you one by one, promote you to panelists, and then I invite you, if you want to, please switch on your camera and we can have a more interactive discussion. I'm busy doing that at the moment, but in the meantime, Mial, perhaps you can have a look at those questions in the Q&A.
Or we can ask
Ryan to just ask the question himself.
Yes. So Ryan posed six questions. So great, Ryan, for your involvement and also for your good questions. Yeah, so one pitfall could be that exploring the idea of stakeholder ethics could lead to businesses having less ethical responsibilities, or businesses taking less responsibilities or implementing less responsibilities. And I think that should not be the idea of also stressing the ethical responsibilities of stakeholders. It's no way to dilute or decrease the ethical responsibilities of companies. And still, companies should do what they should do. And there's a lot to be improved by companies. And when I read every day the newspapers with all the scandals done by companies or happening within companies, of course, they should do a better job, etc., etc. But having said that, it can not be the reason to say, well, then we should first wait until businesses have improved their ethics, and then we can ask stakeholders to also take up their responsibility. I think when stakeholders would take their responsibilities more, that would also help companies to become more ethical. So when we only buy products, for example, that are produced in an ethical way, that would mean that products that are produced in an ethical way would be hard to sell, and that there would be no market. Or when we invest only in companies that are doing well in the field of ethics, when unethical companies have no financial resources anymore, they are then forced to become more ethical. So I really believe in the strength and the power of stakeholders. So that's regarding maybe I think the first two questions regarding your third question. Yeah, so I hope that everyone can read that question, but otherwise I try to explain it. Yeah? So Ryan's question is when there is no financial gain for either party, how can there be then a contract? Well, a contract is not mutual advantage. Does not only mean financial advantage. It can be other. There can be other reasons why I, for example, work for a company. Yeah? That can also be because I would like to develop myself, or I will contribute to a better society, or whatever. Yeah? So the objectives and the advantage of a contract can be quite diverse, but a contract can only be a contract when there is the potential gain for all contracting parties. Yeah? When there is no gain at all for one of the contracting parties, contract theory posits, well, then you can't, then there can't be a contract, because a contract requires that there is advantage for all contracting parties, because otherwise, why would you close or a contract? So for those stakeholders that don't profit at all from a company, then you can say, well, there is no contract. And when there is no contract, those stakeholders also have no ethical responsibilities to and for that company. And I think that's also, realistic, at least I hope, in the sense of, for example, an NGO that only bear the costs or the negative consequences of a company. You can't say that NGO is also responsible for the ethics of that company, or should also deal with that company in an ethical way. When there is no relationship, you have no contract, you have also no responsibility to be open. I should not be open as, for example, consumer to a company of which I don't buy, for example. So in that sense, and then I will maybe pause for a moment, Ryan.
Let's pause there. I know that some people did not accept the invitation to become panelists, probably because they're in a position where they can't switch on their cameras or whatever that reason is. So please feel free to continue using the Q&A. But if you are live with us at the moment, feel free to raise your hand or just unmute yourself and start speaking.
Yeah. Who's going to start speaking?
I start speaking.
There we go, Louise. Thank you.
And it's hard to shut me up. But I really enjoyed your presentation. And I was just wondering, what would your view be on the role of regulation in almost enforcing stakeholders play their part? Like, I'm kind of just observing, and like, ethics wouldn't be my area as such, but I am observing that, say, in the area of sustainability, and there's very much now, like, say, along supply chains, that you're accountable not just to your shareholders anymore, but to your customers and to your suppliers. And even like noticing what's happening with the banks in the US and say with failures and so on, like those banks that are failing now in the US, are those that, like, say, would have been deregulated, or Donald Trump would have kind of removed the regulatory part from them. And I sometimes think that if there's a regulatory oversight, that maybe stakeholders are more inclined to play their role, or maybe you've different views.
So great question, because well, the regulator could also be a stakeholder, and is in most cases a stakeholder when there is at least a contract, or when the regulator represents society with whom the company has a contract. So in that sense, yeah, regulators have also a responsibility. And in many cases, they also take their responsibility. I support that line of reasoning, but at the same time, when talking about stakeholder ethics, I would not say it's about the responsibilities of banks or multinationals, because that's the ethical responsibilities of those businesses. It's about the responsibilities of all those other stakeholders next to the regulator that they can also play a role. And I would suggest that regulators especially encourage stakeholders to take the responsibility. And that could be in your phrase of deregulation, when the deregulation means also encouraging and stressing the responsibilities of stakeholders, that they also take the responsibilities. But I think governments and regulators can also implement all kinds of regimes or policies that help stakeholders to take their responsibilities. And decentralization, I think, could also be a good signal that I'm afraid that nowadays many stakeholders expect that the regulator will cover the ethics of a company. And that we all look to the regulator and it's their responsibility. But when I still buy a bad product, or when I still invest in a bad company, or when I still supply to a bad company, well, I am bad in that sense. So stressing more the responsibility of stakeholders, because, well, for those five grounds, I would suggest, yeah, regulators have an important part as a stakeholder, but also in encouraging all stakeholders to take their responsibilities.
Yeah, that's actually it's a nice way of looking at it. I don't know if governments do that or regulators do that, but it would be great if they did encourage it the other way around. But thank you for that.
Yeah, let's be hopeful. Yeah.
Thanks, Louise, for that question. I think it touches also on that very important sort of distinction that we use sometimes between what's legal and what's ethical. So as we see regulators become more active in this field, in areas like sustainability or ESG, or what we would traditionally, you know, classify as ethical or corporate responsibility issues, obviously that line is shifting, I think, a little bit more towards forcing companies to do it, not because they want to, but because they have to. That is an interesting shift, I think, that we're seeing at the moment.
Yeah. At the same time, I see some regulators really trying to protect the rights of stakeholders, for example, in the financial sector, protecting the rights of consumers. And of course, it's very good, but only protecting the rights without also pointing out the responsibilities consumers have. Mm. Yeah, you have also a responsibility when you buy a product to explore what that product is, for example. Yeah? So I think also in that sense, regulators should point out more, not only protecting the rights but also the obligations and the duties and the responsibilities of stakeholders. So, yeah.
Thanks very much. So if I may, I want to ask a question and play a little bit devil's advocate here.
I'm used to that. Yeah.
So what would you say to sort of the following response to this is to say, hang on, what you're trying to do here with an argument like this is really to deflect from the fact that the business sector or the corporate environment is responsible for most of the things that are wrong in the world at the moment. And that if we look at a list of stakeholders, you know, we can identify the corporations, the suppliers, the investors as all being part of the business community. And it's because of various types of unethical conduct between them and amongst them that we really have all the sort of the problems that we experience at the moment. Now you're trying to shift the argument here to say other stakeholders, you know, really have responsibilities, whereas they would quite often, you know, present them as the victims in terms of, you know, being getting the short end of the stick in terms of unethical corporate behavior. How would you respond to those more cynical comments in terms of stakeholder ethics?
Yeah. I'm afraid that this cynical view is especially prevailing nowadays. Businesses are responsible for their ethics, and when there are unethical practices, it's the responsibility of businesses, and they fail. And many problems in the world are caused by companies, and companies should do their job better. But at the same time, as long as people work for those companies, as long as people invest in those companies, as long as people supply to those companies, as long as people buy products from those companies, I think everyone is to blame. Because everyone has also a responsibility. So I think that when stakeholders would also be more aware of when they have a contract, as stressing a hypothetical contract or implicit contract with the company, they should be more aware of their responsibilities. When I buy a product, I should explore or at least try to understand what kind of company that is. When I invest money, I should try to inform myself to get an understanding. What is the ecological footprint of that company, or what is the societal impact of that company? And it's all comparative. You should buy somewhere and you should invest somewhere. But at the same time, that cynical view prevents us maybe from really breakthroughs, because when we all depend and all wait until companies do the right thing, we are those companies. So we make those companies. So looking to the other means, we have to look to ourselves, and we all together are companies. So that would be my more positive view. And hopefully also a view with more impact.
Thanks, Mio. We have a question from Helmut. Helmut, I have unmuted, or you can unmute yourself, but you're welcome to just ask your question directly.
Train, I didn't ask a question and I have difficulties to connect, so apologies. Thank you for the presentation.
Oh, thank you very much.
That's the best question ever. Thank you. Great. Yeah.
Okay.
Similar questions are welcome.
There's a comment from Malgorzata in the Q&A mail. I think we need to educate our society that we all are stakeholders and we all are responsible. I suppose that links to the comments that you made a moment ago as well.
And I become aware, and I also say that to myself, by the way. So I have also a pension, but my pension fund invest, for example, in some companies that were in the media or in the newspapers a few weeks ago, that they do a bad job regarding high profits now, while they are in the energy sector profiting from the energy crisis. Mm. Two streets from where I live, there's the oil or gas station, Lukoil. That's owned by a Russian company. And I tend to also go with my car to that gas station because it's close by. So I have also said to myself, "Oh wait, when I fill my car with gas that comes from a Russian supplier, I also support that war." It's educating society, but it's also educating ourselves.
Thanks very, very much. I see Ryan has just posed another question, and we are sort of moving towards the end, but perhaps we'll make this the last one. Mio, any insight on the speed of artificial intelligence technology versus ethical response? As AI gets smarter, it gets faster and can cause more harm before we know it. So would you perhaps like to respond to that, and perhaps also just a few concluding remarks before we wrap up?
Good point. So when I would bet on what would create the next financial, economic, ethical, sustainable crisis. That would be that we are run out of control due to algorithms and AI. But that's not the scope of this session. I would say that AI helps us as stakeholders to take our responsibilities better when AI provides us more information about, say, the ethical performance of companies. So in that sense, yeah, I think AI will be very helpful in making more transparent what the ethical footprint or performance of companies is, so that based on that information we can better decide on whether or not to be a stakeholder and how to behave towards that company as a stakeholder. So yeah, instead of a cynical view and seeing everywhere obstacles and pitfalls, yeah, I like to conclude in a positive way, in a hopeful way, that by what was also written down in the chat, when we educate society better and more using AI, using regulators to also encourage the responsibilities of stakeholders. Yeah, stakeholders will change businesses, not businesses themselves, but businesses are we also as a stakeholder. So we as society do then a better job. So that's it for now. Thank you.
Well, on that very positive note, thank you so much again for sharing your views with us today. I think it was a fascinating session, and thank you very much for that. Our final event in this year's series will take place 2 weeks from today on the 30th of March. That's a session that will be moderated by my colleague, Dr. Ulrich Leich-Dubolt. And our guest speaker in the final session will be Professor Judith Walls, who's the Chair for Sustainability Management at the University of St. Gallen in Switzerland. And she will talk about strategy and governance. So please have a look on our website, register for that one if you are interested. And the recording of today's session, as well as the previous sessions in this year, but also the previous years, all available on the Trinity Business School website. Well, once again, thank you very much. Hartelijk bedankt. And we look forward to staying in touch with you. And thanks, everybody, for attending today's session. Bye-bye.